When deploying our applications and VMs into the cloud, one thing that we do have to keep in mind is how sensitive they'll be to network latency. Now, network latency is the delay that happens when two things are trying to communicate over a network, and we're limited, of course, by the speed of light, at least for now. But as we continue to grow and expand into the cloud itself is also growing at a humongous rate. So where you place your resources is going to start to have more of an impact. Now, to reduce network latency and keep performance as high as possible, we've got several choices, and we'll certainly dig into some of that today, but none of them is going to get as low at latency as the subject of today's video, and that's proximity placement groups. I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy. Proximity Placement Group is a logical construct that we set up in Azure that is going to link our VMs as close as possible together. Now, in a previous video, we talked about Azure Dedicated Hosts and how that was a VM that you would have in your subscription dedicated to you, and you could spin up multiple VMs on that host. And if you missed that video, you can check it out in the YouTube card at the top. Where Proximity Placement Groups differ is that you will be able to expand beyond just a single VM family or SKU type. You could actually combine multiple different kinds of SKUs together and put them in close proximity within this placement group. So let's start off in our docs, because there's a few things we have to go through to have this all make sense. So for Proximity Placement Groups, we're going to go to Products, and then in here we can go to Windows or Linux Virtual Machines. And then over on the left, we want to go to Concepts, Availability and Performance, and go to Co-location. So in the dock here, you can scroll down and see a graphical example of what a placement group is going to do. And this is where we could take different types of systems or availability sets, scale sets, and we could put them all within a group that's going to put them as close as possible together so that we get as low a latency as possible. So this does bring up some limitations, for example, availability zones. So when looking at availability in Azure, starting off on the right side, we have our different Azure regions that have hundreds of miles in between them. And inside those regions, there are data centers. Depending on how many data centers there are and where they are located, there may also be availability zones. So we see here region 2 on the bottom has just data centers in it, no availability zones. But the top one, region 1, does have data centers in availability zones. So zooming in on that, here's our region, and this one has 3 availability zones. Now, availability zones themselves are not necessarily limited to 2 data centers per zone. There could be 2, there could be several more. It just depends on the size of that region. Then inside that region's availability zones, we have the data centers themselves. Within those data centers, they all have their own independent power, cooling, generators, backup, and equipment like hosts and storage. And then within there is where we provision the VMs. So the proximity placement group is going to be dealing with the hosts, where they're located in the racks, in the data center, within the availability zone within the region. So you cannot have a proximity placement group spanning multiple regions or multiple availability zones. They would be just too far apart to have that same low dedicated latency that we can get within a single data center. So now, considering the blast radius of this diagram, you'd have to then concern yourself with high availability and disaster recovery of your applications, but that's a little out of the scope of this immediate video. If you're interested in looking more into that, we do have a whole series on disaster recovery and migrations, so you can go check that out in the YouTube card. So some of the other things around the network latency reduction that we're trying to gain by using proximity placement groups means that we need to turn on accelerated networking. Now, for accelerated networking, let's go back to the main page of the Azure docs, and we'll go to products. We'll scroll down for networking and then go to our virtual networks. And under the how-to guide section over here on the left, we'll go under deploy, then under virtual machines, and create VM with accelerated networking, and we'll click on this first link. And this is using a technology that's called single root IO virtualization, or SRIOV. And this is a technology whereby we let the network card do some of the heavy lifting for us. Now, it's a little hard to see here in this graphic, so let's animate it. So over on the left side, we have our traditional networking without SRIOV, and this is where the network traffic goes from the VM to the VM's network card. Then it's going to hit the virtual switch inside the VM host, then passing to the physical network card to the physical switch. Now, this is certainly fine for almost all of your processes, but considering latency, we want as fast a throughput as we can. So over on the right side, we have accelerated networking. So the traffic goes from the VM to the NIC, and then it's going to bypass the virtual switch inside the host directly to the physical NIC where the processing of that network request is going to be done to the physical switch. So the processing happens much faster because we're bypassing a whole hop in the process, as well as we're offloading that from the CPU of the host to the network card processor itself. So not every VM SKU in Azure supports accelerated networking. This requires this technology baked into the network card, which is dependent on which host family you're using. So over on the limits and constraints link on the right, you can see which VM SKUs are supported right here. Now there are ways that you can use PowerShell to enable this on existing workloads or use it to create workloads. That's all in the docs here, but we're going to walk through this in the Azure portal. So at the top of the portal, first thing we're going to do is hit plus to create a new resource, and we can click this link to deploy a Windows server, and we'll create a new resource group for this, and we'll just call that Prox group and hit OK. And we'll call this Prox VM1 and put it in the East US region, and then we'll build this on a 2019 VM image. And scrolling down, we've got our VM size. So here we're going to hit change. Now, if you've watched our videos before, you know I favor the B2MS size. However, when we go to the networking screen here, we're going to see that accelerated networking does not work on this particular SKU. So we're going to have to go with something else. So for today, per our documentation, we'll be going with a D4S V3. So we'll hit select for that and then hit next for our disks. And I'm fine with a premium SSD on this VM. We'll hit next. So we will need a network for this, and I'll leave these settings as is. And then as we scroll down, we see accelerated networking has been enabled. And then if you mouse over the tooltip here, it not only tells you what it is, but you get a quick link to get over to the accelerated networking docs that we were just looking at. And clicking ahead to the advanced screen, now we have to make a choice. We can at this point choose to use a dedicated host and select that and select our particular host that matches our VM family. However, if we do, Proximity Placement Group will not be able to be selected. And that's because this basically does the same feature. The difference being that Proximity Placement Groups do not have to all belong to the same VM family. We can mix and match sizes and SKUs. Whereas host groups, you have to use the same VM family as you are building your system. So if you have a D series host, you cannot have an M series VM. Whereas a proximity placement group, you can mix and match these things all you want as long as they're in the same region or same availability zone, however you're building those out. Now, I'm not actually going to select this here because we'll do that after the fact, but I wanted you to just see that. So moving on to our tags. And I've added my cost center tag here, and we'll hit the review and create button. Everything looks good here, so let's create. So VM1 has finished building, and then under networking in the blade, we can see that accelerated networking is enabled. So back in our resource group, I've also provisioned a second virtual machine in the background, but I also wanted to walk you through creating a VM scale set. So we'll hit add for this. And we'll search for virtual machine scale set and click that and then click create. So I'll call this Prox VMSS1 and then we'll put it in the East US, and I'm not going to currently select an availability zone. Under the orchestration section, we're going to leave it on virtual machine scale sets and then select our appropriate image, which will be 2019 data center, and then we'll select our VM size. So we'll add a few filters here just to make it a little easier to find the appropriate VM. So we'll click add filter, and then you select any one of these particular data points, and I'll select generation, and then I'll make sure that it's on current because I want only the latest virtual machine hardware. And I'll add one more filter here, and this will be for the vCPUs, and I'll just limit this to 4. And then I want to sort this by cost so I can find the right resource. and I'll pick the F4S V2 for this, and we'll hit select, and then add the rest of our information. And we'll also turn on the Azure Hybrid Use Benefit, and we did a prior video on ways to save money in Azure up here in the top right if you're interested in that. We'll click Next, and for this one, we'll select Standard SSDs and hit Next for Networking. And we'll have this go to the same virtual network that we just created. And then, as you can see in the network interface section, accelerated networking is currently turned off. And we can change this by clicking the edit button. So here's where we'll create the network card's name, and you can change that if you would like. What subnet we'll be deploying these systems to, and whether or not we'll have a network security group enabled, which I'm going to turn off at this point. And here's where we just turn on accelerated networking. So we'll skip ahead here to the tags, and I'll add my cost code tag and then hit the review and create button. And everything looks good, so let's build it. Now while that's deploying, let's build a placement group. So at the top in the search bar, we'll type proximity, and there's our proximity placement group service. We'll click on that and then click the button here to create. So we'll put our placement group into our prox resource group, and we'll put that in the East US where our resources are. And then we need to give it a name, and we'll hit next and then put our tags. And we've added a tag for our cost center, our application of the Azure Academy. This is a lab environment for the IT business unit with a maintenance window of Thursday at 6 p.m. We'll hit review and create there, and then hit the create button. And here's where we stand. We've got our two virtual machines created, as well as our VM scale set and our proximity placement group. Now, the VM scale set, just like a virtual machine under networking in the blade, is where you can see that accelerated networking is enabled. Now, the proximity placement group itself, well, there's not a whole lot to it. It's just a logical container that we need to put stuff into. But we can't do that from here. We've got to do it from the virtual machines. Now, the VMs themselves under configuration in the blade is where you can make this change, just like where you can add host groups. You need to have the VM in a deallocated state in order to change this on existing VMs. So let's power these guys down. We'll go to all of our virtual machines, and we'll select our proximity guys and turn them off. And while that's going, let's go to our virtual machine scale set, and we have to deallocate this one as well. So now that the deallocation is complete, we can assign these to our proximity placement group. So inside the VM, we'll go to configuration, and there is the proximity placement group selector, and we'll just pick our group and hit save. And now if we go back to our resource group and we get our VM scale set under configuration, we can load our proximity placement group here as well. And now that we've added our systems to our proximity placement group, when we go back in there, we can see that there they are registered with our group. So you can look at this as two database servers sitting here inside a proximity placement group with a VM scale set front end as a whole application, all tightly coupled together for lower latency and better performance. So let's see some of this in action. So there's a few different ways that we can test latency that's actually covered in our docs. So we'll go to products, and we'll scroll down to networking, and then virtual networks. And on the left under the how-to guides, we'll go to configure, and under there we'll go to optimize network throughput. Now, in case you're using a VM SKU that cannot use accelerated networking, it doesn't mean you're completely out in the cold. There is a way to do something similar using reverse side scaling, and there is a easy PowerShell command that you can use here to turn that on. So I've got the PowerShell terminal inside Visual Studio Code opened. And I know I said in the past that I haven't been using VS Code, and I'm just actually getting into it. So any tips or anything that you could give me, I'd appreciate it if you could put those in the comments field as I start learning this tool. And I'm doing this because there's going to be some cool things coming to the Azure Resource Manager and templates and blueprints. So if you're interested in that stuff, click the subscribe button so you don't miss our upcoming video on that. But I've got the PowerShell terminal opened here, and I'll just run a quick command of get-netadapter-rss and hit enter. And as long as you see that enabled is true here, then you should be good to go. And this is generally on by default on Windows, and the same equivalent feature is on by default on all modern Linux distros. And you can see more of that in the docs here in case you can't use accelerated networking and have to rely on RSS. But in the table of contents here, if we come out of configure and go to troubleshoot, and we scroll down a little bit, there is a link here to test VM network latency. And this doc, it goes through a bunch of different things explaining latency, how it works, how to test for it. And specifically, there is a link here to download Latte for Windows or SockPerf for Linux to do actual latency tests. Ping, which is a very commonly used network tool, tests for connectivity, but it doesn't actually test latency at all. And that's called out here in the docs. You know, ICMP is just something that doesn't do this. And if you scroll down a little further, then you can see the tests that we're going to run. And so there is first here a firewall rule to allow Latte through your firewall. And then there is some stuff here for running an actual test. And we're going to do this from my local machine here over my VPN to Azure. So this is one of my virtual machines up in Azure, and I've already downloaded Latte to this machine. And this is a client server test. So we'll set up this VM in Azure as our server. And we'll do that by calling Latte with dash A, which is the IP of our server. And there's our local IP address and a port. By default, this is going to do 10,000 iterations on this test, but I'll kick this off on the server side. And this lets us know that it's ready. And then back on my client in VS Code, I'll run Latte here. And the dash C flag lets us know that this is the client talking to our server on the same port. And this is our latency in microseconds, which is not great, admittedly, but this is over my VPN. So let's see what this is like from a VM to another in Azure. So on the left, we've got our server restarted and we've got another VM in Azure where I'll kick off the client. And this again will do 10,000 iterations. And that only took about a second or two. And you can see the latency here from VM to VM in Azure. This is definitely much better than what we had over our VPN. So I've got our proximity VMs set up here. So on the left, we've still got our Latte server. And on the right, we've got both of our hosts with accelerated networking enabled. So we'll do one test first from accelerated networking here with our VM1 over back to our server that does not have it enabled. And just with one side of the equation set up, we've got 400 microseconds latency. So a big improvement even over Azure to Azure VMs. Let's try this again now. We'll go with VM1 running Latte as a server. And so for this test, we need to find the IP of our local system, which we can find with ipconfig. And there is our IP address. So now for Latte, we'll use that for our server IP and we'll start that up. And then over here on VM2, we'll run the Latte command and we'll have it talk back to VM1. And you can see that that took 73.55 microseconds. It is certainly the lowest latency connection that you could get in the cloud. So I hope that you've enjoyed looking at proximity placement groups and accelerated networking, ways that we can position your VMs in the cloud to reduce your network latency and give you the highest amount of performance possible between different VMs. So if you thought that this video was good, please give us a thumbs up. And while you're down there, click on the subscribe button if you haven't already and join us here at the Azure Academy and contribute down below to the discussion that goes on if you have any questions or suggestions on any videos that you'd like us to do in the future. We're certainly looking for your feedback and how we can improve helping you all to learn more about Azure. And if you'd like to get an email notification when our videos come out, which is roughly once a week, you can click on that email bell down there as well. Thanks very much for joining us today, and we will see you in the next video. Happy learning.